over the last few months, COVID-19, also known as the coronavirus, has been spreading like wildfire. It's an invisible threat that shows no mercy. In this documentary, I will interview the very people affected by this virus, from everyday workers to business owners, even celebrities. This is the front line. This is history. This is a coronavirus documentary. Chapman, and welcome to the coronavirus documentary. In this film, I'll be seeing how this virus has affected so many people, how it's affected so many different lives, and you will get many different viewpoints from many different people. You know, a lot has happened very fast. A lot has escalated very fast. Just a few days ago, or maybe a couple weeks ago now, you know, everything was normal. You know, people were talking about the coronavirus. It hit the United States. All of a sudden, it's crazy, you know, how things escalated so fast. Just this morning, actually last night, I seen that, I think it was Ohio, shut down all the bars and local restaurants. So I seen that, I'm like, ooh. And I kinda understand how government protocol works, understand the dynamics of stuff like that. So I understand about quarantines and, you know, I love science. And I knew that Michigan was going to be next. So we are ordered, you know, to shut down all the bars in the state by 3 p.m. And they won't be opening until further notice. So I wanted to go to a few locations, a few bars.
They gave you till 3 o'clock. When did you get that phone call? Or about?
I never got a phone call. I woke up this morning and saw it on the news. Then all my employees were calling me, and I was trying to learn as much as I could about it. I did see Gretchen Whitmer on the news, and as far as I know, she said that we're closing as of 3 p.m. today, and that the word she used was that we're temporarily closing all bars and restaurants. So I don't know how long that means for, and that's the big question in my mind.
I think it's sad for us small business owners, but if it makes us not have the problems other countries have had, I guess that's something we're going to have to do, because we'd like as few deaths as possible, really. I mean, I'd like to be a selfish person, but I really can't. I mean, if more people live because we're not around each other, so be it. That's what has to happen.
Every tipped employee like myself is going to be having lost wages for the next 2 weeks. Employees out there working Meijer or Stryker or something like that, you know, it's fine for them because the government's saying that they'll still get a paycheck. Tipped employees, we don't get that.
Even though we're in very, very rough times and spirits are down, that didn't mean anything. When I was in the bar, one of the customers, I refused to give an interview unless he was allowed to buy me shots. And for every interview that I did at Angel's Gentlemen Club, I had to take a shot.
I'm not overly panicked, not overly scared. As of the news this morning, obviously, if you're under the age of 60, the death rate is almost zero. It's scary, especially for our elderly. But you know, when I think pandemic, I think zombie apocalypse and everything else. So I'm comfortable with people doing what they have to do. I'm not comfortable with people fighting grocery stores over bottled water and toilet paper, but you know, they do that over everything else. So human nature is human nature.
I think the media has overhyped it. Hopefully, as I say that, you hear one thing, you want to believe one thing, then you hear another. It sucks because all the sports are canceled, so that pisses me off. That's where it started in the NBA, is my two favorite players. Gobert and Mitchell.
I was very skeptical at first. I thought that we were just kind of overreacting quite a bit. But with all the countries like shutting down, like banning everything, like all businesses are shutting down, they're not letting people together at all. I'm kind of worried now. Like now it's real, right? Like now it's serious.
Coronavirus may kill 3% of the population if everybody got infected and it would overrun the hospitals, but hunger, starvation, poverty, deprivation, that will kill many, many, many more. Hunger kills everyone. No one can survive without food or water.
In everyone's mind right now, that's in this industry, that in entertainment industry, bars, restaurant, food industry, is how long is this going to last?
I don't think the virus has run its course. I think probably the majority of people will get it from the supermarkets at this point. I mean, the supermarkets are packed. I just walked through Meijer, and it's crazy in there.
This thing's going to go away. I think it's way overhyped. As I say, I think, I'm also saying I hope. But if I'm wrong, then nobody wants to be wrong about this.
Now I'm looking at my safe full of thugs before ammunition and going, well, let's say my kids aren't going to starve.
If it's like a month, that's going to be rough. I'm concerned about all the small businesses, like the small restaurants, family owned. Without this income, like they're just not. They're not
going to
be able to reopen the doors, you know?
It'd be interesting to see the impact that it has when people can't socialize for a while, because we're very social creatures. Me personally, very social creature on a regular basis, so we'll see how that works out.
It seems like it's a fear factor thing going on right now. It is better to be safe than sorry. I mean, you'd rather find out later that you did the right thing.
I don't think that we'll cure it. I think what they're hoping is to keep people away from each other long enough that the ones that have it, their signs show up. They can be isolated. And we'll make it through this.
I just hope that what they are doing works, and works fast, and maybe a cure and a vaccine come out. Obviously, you know, this it's crippling the economy. Besides the fact that it's killing a lot of people and there's a lot of sick people out there. So obviously, you know, the measures they're taking, I just hope that it works and works fast, and in the economy, and everybody can kind of get back to some normalcy in their life.
I want to go to Walmart because Walmart has been crazy. You know, people have been buying a whole bunch of toilet paper. I understand the toilet paper thing, but I don't. You know, I guess it's a way to control the situation. People, they feel like they have more control when they hoard stuff, when they buy stuff. So I'm going to go into Walmart, my local Walmart, and I'm going to get some interviews and see what people think about the virus as well.
Overall about the coronavirus.
Are you somebody about to die. That's what I think's about to happen. It ain't going to be me, but somebody about to die.
Just a normal virus. If you catch it, catch it. There's nothing to be worried about.
It's a little frightening because I did ask my elders, like around the shop, like 50, 60 in age, and they're saying that they've never even seen anything like it. So honestly, yeah, it's a little frightening, but it doesn't help with everyone else like panic buying.
Right now, I think people are overreacting to it. I mean, yes, it's serious, but it's not that serious. Like, yes, you're supposed to stay home, but not to the point where you need to stockpile everything.
Just sacked this all yesterday.
So, do you think it's going to get better, or do you think it's going to get worse?
If people do the right stuff and just stay away from the people that have it.
Okay. So, on a 1 to 10, how worried are you about the virus?
Not that worried. I already stepped in my feet a long time ago.
I would say we're probably just starting to get into it. Probably gonna be a couple months. That's what everyone else has been saying, but
I ain't nervous at all. I'm smart. Dummies die.
How's it affect? Is it affecting you whatsoever?
Yeah, because I can't go nowhere. I can't let the dummies get my kids.
Continue in Walmart, and we're in Walgreens right now, and we've been looking for toilet paper. So, what's your whole thoughts on that?
I think it's ridiculous because no symptoms have to do with needing toilet paper. So I don't understand why people are really stockpiling just that and not as much food. Like, I get if you were quarantined, you're gonna need toilet paper, but not that much. And I also don't think that people who don't have children shouldn't be trying to get formula or baby wipes or diapers to sell it for a lot higher price.
One to freak out unless you give me a legitimate reason, like if you shut down my work, then that's something different.
Your money, does it mess with your money any?
I sell everything. I spend flowers.
This is wipes because I'm an aunt. I've been an aunt since I was 3, so I've had a lot of nephews and nieces, and right now I have some little nephews and She came up and she tried to grab the wipes, and I told her she needed to back up.
Oh my God.
Because there were still wipes on the shelf.
Until the government decide enough people died, who knows?
So you don't think, no idea?
It depends on how many people die and how fast. If the government decides that they're dying fast enough, then they might just get rid of them. But if they're not dying, then it's gonna be a minute. But they're not gonna mess up everybody's money, so I bet you it don't last long.
That's true.
So right, yeah, when the rich people feel it, I bet you it don't last long. The broke people, we gonna feel it.
They're gonna implement that curfew?
Probably, curfew-wise, but it's like what, like before 10?
Yeah.
So it won't really mess with too much that they haven't already messed with, like restaurants and bars. Because that's usually what's open later. Or like this place, you can obviously see their hours of business have changed from 6 to 11 instead of 24.
Honestly, if people were to do what they are supposed to do, I feel like it would be knocked out pretty quickly. But if people keep up the way that they have been, I'm sure it will last for a while.
The Angels, I usually host Foxy Boxing, which is usually very much fun for the fans and the customers. People love it. But this St. Patrick's Day, we were supposed to do Jello Wrestling. And like I said, the bars are shut down. Not only was Angel shut down, every other bar is shut down. St. Patrick's Day is usually a happy day, and it was crazy. The streets were completely bare, completely empty. I just wonder when all this is gonna be over. In these craziest times, there's not really too much to do. So I figured just so I won't go insane, I'll go train with my friend Rachel. I've known her for 20 plus years. We've been really good friends. She studies Muay Thai, and I help her with her boxing and just her overall martial arts skills. This is something I kind of need to do to keep myself sane. And as of now, you know, we can go out, but I got a feeling that soon even Michigan is going to be on lockdown and we won't be able to go out. So while I can still go out, I want to get as much training in as I can, and also get an interview with her and her son's girlfriend.
Yeah. We have had an increase in hours at my job available, which is actually new for this time of the year.
I don't think it necessarily affects me other than working. With my job, I can't work until after this kind of blows over.
It's affected my life in a few ways. Number one, I can't go to church, and that's a big part of my life.
Well, I still have to go to work, so it hasn't affected my life that much so far. I just have to take extra precaution because we do have family members that I stay with, and they are high risk.
I'm blessed because a lot of people don't have any hours, don't have money, don't have a way to feed their families in the next couple weeks.
Stay home more. I like to get out to the stores, which I have a little bit, but you know, just for necessities, which is what we're supposed to do, so.
And with school, I was doing an online class anyway, but now it's kind of difficult for my school to do online because our system wasn't built for every class to be online, so it's crashed. So now teachers have to scramble to find other means of connecting with their students.
I just wash my hands properly like we're supposed to. What I do, we have to wear gloves. I don't wear, when I'm cashiering, I don't want people to feel like I'm isolating them, so I try not to wear the gloves, but I allow my distance, you know, because you don't know who has it nowadays, and because they're not all being tested.
I'm implementing a lot of new policies and procedures for this specifically, so I'm grateful.
I volunteer at the jail twice a week, sometimes three times, and I really miss seeing the ladies there and encouraging them and, you know, helping them out in any way I can.
I've heard speculations of it going into the late summer. I don't think it will go past middle of May.
See many cars out, which is a good thing. And so I'm thinking maybe a good 3 to 4 more months.
I have no idea. I don't think it's going to last as long as they project that it will last. I think it's going to die out sooner, especially with the coming of spring. I know people get flu-like viruses usually in the winter, but a lot of times in the spring, I think it clears up. I could be wrong.
Here, it's supposed to go until July. Like, everything in the whole Kalamazoo was just different. It got really quiet really fast. I'm not used to it. No, it's really weird. It's strange.
As the virus spreads, it's starting to get a lot more dangerous to go out. So I'm going to be doing a lot more video interviews and I'm going to be out less. I'm a very healthy person personally, but I don't want to get it and spread it to anyone else. So I'm being very careful. I have very close friends and family that I do not want to get sick. So from now on, a lot of the interviews that I do, most of the interviews I do are actually going to be via Skype or via Facebook Messenger.
You know, I was traveling, so when we got back, everyone had already picked over stuff. We got lucky.
The day before I arrived to the airport, I received a confirmation saying that I could check into the airport and that everything was going to be okay.
My sister didn't get a cancel, like, flight notice or anything like that. And then they told us that our flight was canceled right when we got there.
The world stopped spinning. It's just like, what in the hell is going on here?
I checked in. I showed up at the airport and there was nobody. Delta was completely shut down. So they ended up having like a janitor kind of person that was there. And he ended up pretty much telling us that Delta ran their last flight out of Ireland.
The two of us, we would check on our flight every single day, like a few times a day, just to make sure that flight was on time.
Because it's, I mean, it's kind of like that over there. Maybe it's changed since then. But their restaurants were still open. People weren't driving around and hoarding and going crazy.
So it was very difficult for us to get out of Ireland. I ended up contacting a friend of mine that is a flight attendant from Delta, and she ended up pretty much helping us get out of pretty much Ireland.
For St. Paddy's Day. And when we landed was when we found out that St. Paddy's Day was canceled. And we didn't know what we were getting ourselves into.
It's like America's gone. Like apocalyptic, self-centered instead of helping people, crazy.
They almost rejected us when we got to the hotel because they have a list of like places that end up having the virus or who is more contaminated. So if your country's in that, they will reject you away from the hotels. No hotel was taking anybody if their country was infected.
38B and 38A, will you like follow me? Like CDC wants to talk to you. And nobody else is getting off the plane.
They offered us a place to stay with drinks. You come here and they're just like, nope, can't have my toilet paper.
And then they say right on the door, if you do have any coffee or anything, do not enter the hotels. And then they did say if you do end up getting sick while you're in the hotel, they did have a quarantine area inside the hotel that you would end up having stuck inside.
Off the plane, there was like probably like six cops, four CDC people like waiting to talk to us. And I was like, what is going on?
Actually, the flight back from Ireland that we switched ours, we had our own rows. Everyone was really nice. Food was still good. They still gave us our refreshments and drinks and our in-flight meals and snacks.
So it was very scary. We did end up seeing quite a bit of young homeless people on the streets, which was kind of surprising. And they had suitcases like we had, so you could tell that they definitely weren't like homeless. But I think it was because they were getting turned away from hotels and airports and were not allowing them to spend the night in it because of everything.
Mom was asking about my cough, and some of my other friends were asking how my cough was doing. Never once did we, like, joke about the coronavirus or anything. But since they were looking at my phone, they seen that I had some of the symptoms.
We didn't have any problems. Everyone was welcoming, and I mean, people talk about these horror stories. My question is how were you acting in the situation?
Pretty much getting the last flight into Detroit in general to get home. If we did not catch that flight, then we would have been stuck in Ireland for 30 days.
We didn't wait in any lines. We literally walked in. It took us maybe 20, 30 minutes to get through the initial screening.
But getting out of Ireland was a nightmare. I mean, we went through so much to get home.
Like no airport staff whatsoever in there. It was all like military and cops working in the airport in Detroit.
Where you take your shoes off and they go through your luggage and any liquids, but it wasn't anything extra special. It was the exact same process as you would fly normal.
As soon as our door opened, before anybody could get off the plane, they had called me and my sister to get off the flight. And I was like, okay, this is scary. So we get greeted by three cops and we get greeted by the CDC.
I was in New York for a couple days. It was, again, it was kind of, everything was still open for the most part. We did the Statue of Liberty. My 79-year-old grandmother walked all the way to the top. We all did that together. The subway actually took pictures, and we were the only people standing there in the subway.
My heart is pounding. Like, I have no idea what's about to happen. Like, just getting greeted with all these cops, I'm like, what just happened? Because we were the only ones to get pulled off the plane. So when we got pulled off the plane, they ended up pulling us aside, and they're like, so we have confirmation that you guys have been going on Facebook and on Twitter and talking about the coronavirus and making it a joking matter.
Me aside and like asking questions and stuff. So then when I went to go get the luggage, like they had a dog come up and sniff the bag every time. And then they had dogs like sniffing us as we left.
Actually took a stretch Hummer ride all the way around New York because their business was so slow. He's just like, $80 and you guys got me for the next hour. I didn't see anybody coughing. I didn't see anybody acting crazy.
I had gotten onto my social media. They know how serious it was and how serious I had taken it, especially being stuck in Ireland with this disease.
The crazy stuff everyone's talking about, it was just like, I don't get it.
They were like, some of them were like in hazmat suits. Like, we've never seen anything like this before. I never thought I would see something like this before.
I didn't have any of those experiences, and we were right downtown.
This is questions on where we were, where we came from, and we had told them, so they continued us down, so there was like arrows, and you just kind of follow the arrows, and there's cops just everywhere. There's so many cops I've never seen.
Again, I mean, I have older family. My dad has underlying health conditions, and I get it, but I feel like everything's been an overreaction. There's no cure for any of the flus, just like there's not with this. But now with this, you're looking at a worldwide economic depression.
Five shows, five events I was supposed to work at, all getting canceled. Boom, boom, boom. It was like dominoes.
If I would, I think after this weekend, I would have gotten that call definitely for the Contender Series in June.
I brought my two little brothers out to chill with me out here. They were in Chicago because my parents are in Mexico. And you know, they're stuck out there.
And then it was just like domino effect all over the country. Every event that I had coming up were kickboxing, two MMA events here in Michigan. And you know, that's a lot of money. That's a lot of money, you know, especially those bigger shows, you know, like Glory and, you know, BKFC, you know.
I had my outlet like to the same extent that I normally do, which is fighting and training. And I haven't been able to cut hair, which is another thing that, you know, keeps me grounded. And
we wait to hear what the governor has to say. You know what I mean? It's kind of hard to, you know, you don't want to postpone something two times. You know, that's pretty rough.
Restaurants and everything are getting shut down everywhere. And, hey, these people ain't got no freaking money. And they can't afford to fix their vehicle. So it's like, I'm feeling it, man.
It was a blow. Mentally, you know, I was a little depressed over it for a little bit. Just didn't want to change, didn't want to get out of bed. I was pretty pissed off, but, you know, I got right back in there and just did what I had to do.
You know, we're a very essential group of people. You know, we keep the city running. We take care of the water. We take care of the sewer. So, I mean, for us to even be sent home and, you know, be on kind of like a rotating schedule and always on call, it's very weird because, you know, my other work is the type of work where we're always working.
I'm feeling it. My bills stay the same. And, you know, because I'm not a small business corporation, because that's a sort of stipulation that they have. I'm not an SBC, so I don't qualify as a small business.
You can't be upset over anything you can't control, and that's something that I've had to learn to deal with. So, you know, all I can do now is just stay prepared for whatever's to come next, you know.
Hopefully, you know, in a couple of weeks, we can at least have a kind of a control on it where we're not seeing these numbers like double and triple.
Lucky to get that BYB last minute bare knuckle fight down there at the Hard Rock in Fort Lauderdale, because I was able to not only pay my bills, but pay my mom's bills too.
3 weeks ago, when they were shutting the Arnold down, you know, I kind of started like, I'm like, man, that's not good. You know what I mean? I was telling, and then all of a sudden at my work, you know, I think I work for the government, you know, so we got a city hall, we got a fire department, you know, so I was hearing lots of these things weeks ago. You know what I mean? I was getting a lot of this stuff at my actual job, so I was hitting my manager up, you know, my manager company, telling them like, I doubt this fight's going to go through, man. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but
the first one to sign a contract as soon as all this is over and take the fight right away. I'm ready to go.
One is a bartender and the other is a waitress, you know, and her money's set. And she depends on money every single day, and that's what she's been going by a little bit of food with. Sure, she gets, you know, the government benefits and whatnot, but, you know,
as far as food, but it's not that much. And it doesn't really help that, you know, we got hoarders at the grocery store.
Hoarding, and it makes no sense. And then now you have to hoard because they do it. And you go there, you go to the grocery store, and everybody's savage, so you got to turn up the savage too. Otherwise, you're going to go home with no chicken.
All of a sudden, a bunch of my college wrestlers are getting yanked out of their tournaments, you know what I mean, guys that I wrestled with. Yeah, man, so my whole little thing was, is if I'm watching these college students get kicked out of school and do all this other stuff, it didn't mean the governor had to come out and tell us we couldn't do it. I wasn't going to do it.
New York's experiencing super high numbers, you know, and that's just who they have tested. They don't test everybody. You have to meet a certain criteria.
You know, this is probably going to go take our whole summer, so.
Connor just gifted $1 million to their Irish, you know, hospital. Got, like, the biggest, the most damaged area from it. He's giving money to so that these people are staying safe and people have the aid that they deserve. That's the kind of stuff that I've always dreamed of doing. And,
you know, you have to have international travel. Really, really, really severe symptoms, like, you know, I'm going to die symptoms, or, you know, known contact with somebody that has, you know, tested positive for it. If not, you don't get a test.
And it's making people a little more grateful, you know, a little less negative, and people are hopefully starting to see, you know, the better and everything and really counting their stars.
We got tested, and the day we got tested, I was not feeling good at all. She was not feeling good. And then within 48 hours, we got confirmation that we did have the virus. And by then, we knew anyway because, you know, we had high fevers and we're feeling all the symptoms.
Stocked up before I, you know what, when I saw this happening in China, I figured it was going to come this way. So I had already been buying things here and there and kind of putting them aside, toilet paper and, you know, beans and things that you can cook on for a while.
We, as you can see, in the hospital. I am 29 weeks pregnant, and my water had to break very early. So, with being in the hospital and with the virus, we're not allowed visitors. We're allowed one person that can come the entire time, so possibly being here for 7 weeks, I'm only allowed to see one person.
Before we were able to go get tested, we started feeling kind of sick, and that's when I was like, oh boy, we better, you know, stick with the self-quarantine thing.
It is heartbreaking. My son's birthday is Tuesday, and I'm only going to get to spend his birthday with him.
We landed. I knew that it might be a problem, and so I should probably self-quarantine for a couple of days because that's what we were being recommended to do.
You know, I can't help it because my mom is back in Kalamazoo, just like the rest of my family, so there's a sense of worry in me. Like, right now, we can still actually get back, like, the flight's not going every day, but the embassy lets you know, like, on this day, there's a flight going to Chicago.
So, again, we were pretty lucky in that regard to have gotten a confirmation right away. But even without the test, I think we would have stayed anyway because we knew what it was as soon as we started feeling.
Thankfully, in the area that I'm in, this county alone has only had 3 positive tests. But we also don't have tests. So we have no idea how many people really have it, and I don't think it's really hit here yet.
The family on the plane that I saw that was just totally deadly sick, I saw them on the plane, like, all feverish and hacking away, and we all were looking at them like, man, this is not okay. And, like, you know, we're at the airports. I took in 3 or 4 days, I think I was on 6 planes.
No traveling going home, I could pick it up on the way. Come home, give it to my mom, and she's, you know, she could potentially get ill. So it's just kind of hard because being way over here, you know, I can't directly, like, just get you
to
do something.
Me upstairs, I got to labor and delivery, and they asked me again before I was even allowed through the doors where the patients were, have you had a fever? They took my temperature. Have you had a cough? Have you had this symptom? They took me to the room. They did some tests and they confirmed that my water did break, and they told me that they would be admitting me. They don't want to do anything until 34 weeks, so I could possibly be here for another 6 weeks.
So, like, I mean, who knows? It could have been anywhere in that time. I have no idea. I don't think it's really helpful to even try and figure it out where it came from.
I'm praying. I pray that my insurance will cover it. My job so far has been working with me. I guess
one good side of having this virus going on while I'm in here is they haven't given the employees a lot of breaks.
But now they're giving hefty fines if, you know, they catch you out and you really got no reason to be out. So right now, actually, I'm proud of Polish people because from what I see, a lot of people are behaving over here. They're taking it seriously. They're staying home. And then, like I said, when they go out, they respect the space.
All right, it's all about once you have it, just stay at home, you know. So I've been here for over 2 weeks now.
And with me having my water broke, I'm even more at risk for infections and the virus and anything else to affect me.
I don't see any politics involved with this. You know, as soon as the order came over here, they got on it right away, locked everything down. So it doesn't seem like, okay, we're not going to do this because we want to make money off of it some kind of way, like sending people back to work, or we're not going to have enough masks, you know, for the medical staff because we want to make money off it. I don't see any politics, but maybe I'm not looking in the right, you know, places.
At first, I joked a lot about it, how it's crazy, how every election year there's a new, you know, virus, a new breakout, something that happens. So it's kind of interesting that it did happen right at this time. But I would pray that they would not do something like this just for votes or elections or for government, because with the way that the economy is, like, it's crashing. People are going to end up going crazy and probably possibly start killing each other.
It's not like the normal flu at all. Like, when you get hit with the normal flu, you get it immediately. This started off with a little tickle in the back of my throat. I kind of was in denial about it at first. And then, very light fever. And then it slowly just got worse. And then the shortness of breath thing started. Then it went away. After 3 or 4 days, it totally went away, and I thought, that was it. I was going to be a young, healthy person, and this is how it affects me, and everything seemed fine, and I felt pretty unsymptomatic for a day or two, and then it came back really, really hard.
That's unsettling to me is, what's to come? Because, like, this is a whole world. Like, this ain't just a little area. You know, okay, China seems to be back on track now, but in a sense, not. And also, I don't even know if you say everything's clear. I don't know if I'm going to be ready to, like, jump back out there and not be taking precautions, because probably not. I'm going to be wearing gloves when I go to the store.
I had a customer come in. It was an older lady, and she had a mask and gloves on, and I was like, okay, you know, awesome. Like, she's taking precautions. And she was just hacking through the whole store. And please don't come to my line. Please don't come to me. Well, she came to me. I'm like, okay, no. It's all right. I'm like, hey, ma'am, how are you? And she took her mask off. And she set it down on my car. Just started hacking in my face.
This week, it was at peak. And that's when it was, you know, super high fever, sweating all night, not being able to sleep, really hard to breathe. Headaches like I've never felt. I mean, just constant headaches for days. Sinuses all blocked up, obviously. And then really the body aches, like my hair follicles hurt, even like touch. Like everything was really bad for a little while there. It was just miserable. Yeah, it was bad. Like we kept being positive about it, but it sucked. It was really bad.
Trust and believe, I know it gets boring sitting in the house. I'm in a room, but it's doable. Sitting in the house for 2-3 weeks, what's going to stop this is what we need to do.
Hey, I finally feel pretty good. The shortness of breath is still there. And I have, I'm coughing up a lot. There's like some, you know, blood and stuff like that I'm coughing up. They said that that's normal.
Say, you know, don't panic. Just amp up your immune system. Reach out to your people. Check on them. And just do your part, you know, just... You know, if they tell you to stay home, just stay home. You know?
So, I think at worst, super high fever, can't really breathe, gotta stay in bed, everything hurts. That's what it really happens, yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
And I'm pretty healthy, and it's, yeah, so that's how it affects it. And same with my my girlfriend, I don't want to speak for her on here too much, but you know, right, she's around the same age and it affected her as well. The curve is still going up, so it's going to be months. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. It will be months. It's time to not mess around. That's the big thing. Don't mess around. Just say it's not worth it right now. This is more serious than people think it is.
As of 11 o'clock a.m., the governor has shut Michigan down.
As the virus spreads and businesses shut down and people are stuck at home, I'm going to be getting more interviews about what's going on all over the world. So follow my progress, hit that subscribe button. The next episode, I will be covering quarantine lockdowns.